Japan's leaders held a series of emergency meetings on March 11, 2011, soon after the earthquake and tsunami hit the northeast. Then, when things went wrong at the Fukushima Daiichi nuclear power plant, this task force discussed the possibility of a worst-case scenario, reactor meltdowns. But details of their talks show they put off an evacuation order. The country's nuclear watchdog has shed light on the meetings by piecing together an inside account. The earthquake and tsunami knocked out external power and disabled the plant's backup generators on March 11th. Prime Minister Naoto Kan declared a state of emergency at the plant and presided over the first meeting of the task force that evening. The government recently revealed no one took minutes of that or subsequent meetings. Public criticism prompted members of the Nuclear and Industrial Safety Agency to interview the individuals who were on the task force. And they studied the notes that they were taken and reconstructed the minutes. Their document shows an unidentified member of the task force spoke about a worst-case scenario. That person said meltdowns could occur if the core temperatures of the reactors were to rise after backup cooling batteries died in about 8 hours. At that point, the government had yet to issue an evacuation order. The minutes also show another task force member said it might be necessary at some point to clear cities and towns within 10 kilometers of Fukushima Daiichi. The task force met for the third time on the afternoon of March 12. By then, the government had set up a 10-kilometer radius evacuation zone around the nuclear plant. Koichiro Gemba, who was national policy minister at the time, pointed out the possibility of meltdowns occurring at Fukushima Daiichi. He asked if the evacuation zone should be expanded. At 6:25 p.m. on March 12, a hydrogen explosion happened at Reactor 1. The government expanded the no-go area to 20 kilometers. The reconstructed minutes from the task force meetings offer no details on how decisions were made on crucial matters. For example, the review of evacuation zone. This makes it difficult to examine the government's decision-making process during the disaster.
Experts have estimated that 80% of the people who were living near the Fukushima Daiichi plant at the time of the accident were exposed to radioactive iodine. Scientists at Hirosaki University conducted checkups of 65 residents of the surrounding region last April. They found radioactive iodine in the thyroid glands of 50 of them. The team then calculated the amount of the substance each resident had been exposed to. They estimated that five had received dosages exceeding 50 millisieverts. That's the level at which the IAEA recommends taking iodine tablets. The residents with the highest dosage had received 87 millisieverts. That person had stayed within 30 kilometers of the nuclear plant for more than 2 weeks after the accident.
There's a face to the Fukushima disaster. Amiko Numaochi, a high school teacher of 18 years, believes she could be it. Her hair has started falling out. Her once healthy teeth have as well, leaving her dentist dumbfounded. And then there are the unusual rashes running along her thighs. Numaochi lives just 25 kilometers from the crippled nuclear plant. For the past year, she's blogged about her failing health. Now she thinks the radiation and the radiation-tainted food the government says is safe to eat is slowly killing her.
If you keep doing what the government says is all right, this is what happens. I have made myself a test subject to uncover the government's lies.
Deep suspicion over the official handling of the crisis has led parents and teachers to push for independent tests on such things as school cafeteria meals. With children proven to be the most vulnerable to radiation, officials recently bowed to public pressure and announced the amount of radioactive cesium allowed in food will be reduced, in some cases by 20 times. Still, authorities insist the original levels set were safe and that Fukushima's residents are under no threat.
Most of the death was caused by tsunami. And I have not heard any single case of death because of the nuclear radiation.
Here in Japan and internationally, there is intense debate over whether long-term exposure to lower levels of radiation, like what exists in Fukushima, is a risk to human health. There's little science on the matter, and much is unknown.
Likening it to an invisible enemy, Dr. Shintaro Hida, treated thousands of people suffering from radiation sickness in Hiroshima and Nagasaki, long after the atomic bombs were dropped. With Fukushima, he fears the pages of history will be filled with more victims.
There's no doubt a lot of people are already being affected by internal radiation. To say they aren't is wishful thinking on the government's part. They are dismissing the dangers, and they are wrong.
Numa Ochi now spends part of her days caring for dogs left behind by people who fled after the nuclear meltdown. She's vowing to stay on near the plant and hopes her example will convince the government to embrace the concerns of those she says it has abandoned. Steve Chow, Al Jazeera, Minamisoma, Japan.
It's nearly a year since the devastating earthquake and tsunami in Japan. The country is still struggling to deal with millions of tons of debris. So local governments have joined hands to help dispose of it more quickly. 17 local governments outside the disaster area have agreed to accept debris for disposal. But they can't handle it all. Their top officials launched a project to encourage more local authorities to join the effort.
I'm sorry the disposal of debris is going so slowly. Let's work together to produce results.
The disaster last March left an estimated 22.5 million tons of debris. Officials at the Environment Ministry say only a little over 6% has been incinerated or buried. Some local governments are reluctant to accept debris because residents think it may have been contaminated by the nuclear accident.
Industry Minister Yukio Edano says the government will decide whether nuclear reactors should resume operation after local municipalities accept safety assessments by experts. In a live interview with NHK on Thursday, Edano addressed the issue of the country's nuclear reactors, which have been shut down for regular inspections. He said priority should be given to safety rather than to the need for power generation.
A thorough scientific examination of nuclear facilities by experts is a precondition for resuming power generation. Public safety must be confirmed through the objective viewpoints of experts. A decision to restart nuclear reactors will be made only after we obtain the support of local residents.
Edano also commented on Tokyo Electric Power Company, which is facing financial difficulties after the nuclear accident at its Fukushima Daiichi plant. He said if TEPCO receives financial assistance, it cannot tell the government to stay out of its business. Edano reiterated his view that if the company accepts public funds, the government should hold a majority of voting rights for shareholders' meetings.
So long, and thanks for all the fish.
So sad that it should come to this. We try to warn you all, but oh dear. You may not share our intellect, which might explain your disrespect for all the natural wonders that grow around you. So long, so long, and thanks for all the fish.
The world's about to be destroyed. There's no point getting all annoyed.
Lie back and let the planet dissolve. Despite those nets of tuna fleets, we thought that most of you were sweet, especially tiny tots and your friends and women. So long, so long, so long, so long, so long,
so long, so long, so long, so long, so long, so long.